या गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस फ्रेश मॉर्निंग सेशन ऑफ फ्री पेपर्स। वी हैव पैनल ऑफ एस्टीम जजेस विद अस टुडे। आई विल बी इंट्रोड्यूसिंग देम। आवर फर्स्ट जज इज डॉक्टर मिलिंद सबनिस सर, हु इज अ प्रोफेसर एंड हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट डीवाई मेडिकल कॉलेज एट कोल्हापुर, and he is one of my teachers also. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Our second judge is Dr. Kashinath Chaudhary, sir. He is a professor and head of the department at Government Medical College, Aurangabad. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
And our next judge is Dr. Khurshid Barucha. He is a senior ophthalmologist and a professor at HV Desai Eye Hospital, Hadapsar, Pune. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here and consenting to be as the judges of these this free paper session. So we'll be starting the session now. Now I call upon our first delegate to present his paper. Dr. Subhik.
Thank you, Kalyan sir, for a nice introduction. Thank you, all the judges. Dr. Inderjeet Shinde is our first participant, but he had some problem with the login. So we'll start with Dr. Kamlesh Lanje. Dr. Kamlesh, you can start sharing your screen, please.
Yes, sir.
We'll be talking about intravitreal bevacizumab on the spectral domain OCT in patients with macular edema due to various retinal pathologies. Dr. Kamlesh, your time is 6 minutes and I will be keeping your time as you start your presentation.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Please
sir, share. Is it visible?
Yeah, it's slides are visible. Please make it full screen.
Okay, sir. Shall I start now?
Yeah, please.
Good morning, everyone. The topic of my free paper presentation is changes in macular edema by optical coherence tomography in patients receiving intravitreal bevacizumab. It is a retrospective observational hospital-based study. Collection of fluid in layers of macula is called as macular edema. It is a manifestation of various retinal pathologies. Optical coherence tomography is widely used, non-invasive, fast, efficacious, and easy diagnostic tool for detecting macular edema at the earliest. Intravitreal bevacizumab is an anti-vascular endothelial growth factor agent effective in treatment of macular edema and is cost effective compared to its contemporaries. The aim of the study is to study the clinical effectiveness of intravitreal bevacizumab as measured by spectral optical coherence tomography, that is SDOCT changes in macular thickness in patients with macular edema. This was the retrospective observational longitudinal study done in 32 eyes of 30 patients with macular edema due to various retinal pathologies, who underwent intravitreal bevacizumab from January 2018 to April 2019. The data from case record of the
Dr. Kamlesh.
Institutional Ethical Committee approval was taken and off-label use of drug, its potential risk.
Dr. Kamlesh, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Please, your internet connection is slow. Please switch off your video and then present. It will be easier for you.
Okay.
We are not able to hear 2-3 words in between. Just switch off your video and yeah, please continue presentation. Continue, Dr. Kamlesh.
So the study included data of patients 40 years and above having macular edema due to different retinal disorders with minimum 6 follow-ups. A period of 6 months. The patients with vitreous hemorrhages, pseudophakic, patients who underwent pan-retinal photocoagulation and vitrectomy were excluded from the study. At the baseline, patient underwent detailed ophthalmic evaluation, including best-corrected visual acuity, slit lamp examination, IOP measurement, dilated fundus examination. Baseline central retinal characteristics were analyzed using SDOCT through dilated pupil. Standard protocol of intravitreal bevacizumab injection was followed. According to pro-Renata regimen, eyes were given second and third injection after the first and third month follow-up. Changes in best corrected visual acuity, central macular thickness, and parafoveal thickness were analyzed at 1, 3, and 6 months. Detailed analysis of OCT biomarkers was done on follow-up visits. The pair T-test and chi-square tests were used for comparison of the data. For all statistical tests, p-value of less than 0.05 was considered statistically significant. 2.78 years, 30 patients were female and 70% were male. Patients were followed up for mean duration of 6.9 months. Most common cause of macular edema in our study was diabetic retinopathy, followed by retinal vein occlusion, and then hypertensive retinopathy. Main best corrected visual acuity improved from 1.03 at baseline or logMAR chart to 0.61 at 1 month, 0.43 at 3 months, and 0.31 at 6 months, which was statistically significant. The mean central foveal thickness was decreased by around 100 micron at 1 month and was maintained at the third and sixth month follow-up. The mean parafoveal thickness was decreased by around 100 micron at 1 month and was maintained at third and sixth months follow. The first table shows the cystoid spaces resolved in 21%, that is 87.5% patients at 6 months as compared to 24 patients with the cystoid spaces at baseline. Second table shows the hyperreflective foci decreased in all 15 patients at 6 months follow-up as compared to the baseline. The serous macular detachment resolved in 4 patients at 6 months follow-up as compared to the 5 patients at baseline. And ellipsoid zone regenerated in 83.3% patients at 6 months as compared to 12 patients at baseline. This is the case from our study where SBOCT shows progressive resolution of the cystoid spaces and serous macular detachment, decreased in hyperreflective foci and regeneration of ellipsoid zone at 1 month, 3 months, and 6 months follow-up as compared to the baseline in the first image. The cases that did not show complete resolution of the macular edema on OCT after first injection were subjected to repeat injection. Of total 32 eyes, 16 eyes received second injection at first one after first month follow-up. 9 eyes received third injection after third month follow-up. 2 patients did not require second injection as macular edema in them resolved completely at single injection. OCT of 5 eyes did not show total resolution of macular edema at 6 month follow-up, of which 1 eye was subjected to in this study, 83.3. Coming to the discussion, in this study, 83.37 eyes showed improvement in macular edema as shown on prenatal regimen. 16 eyes were given second injection, and 9 eyes were given at third injection at the first and third month follow-up, respectively. Also, the present study assessed the OCT microstructural changes like cystoid spaces, serous macular detachment, hyperreflective foci, and ellipsoid zone, which influenced the final functional outcome. Over the time, the number of patients requiring re-injection reduced from 50% to 28.12%, which indicates bevacizumab may have beneficial cumulative effect, but further studies are necessary to prove this.
1 minute left.
So, Aravalloje et al. Also showed similar decrease in central macular thickness with intravitreal bevacizumab at 6 months follow-up. Study conducted by Aravalloje et al., LAMP DS, and Hauge et al. Also showed similar improvement in mean best corrected visual acuity as present study at 6 months follow-up on logMAR chart. Ocular and systemic side effects of bevacizumab were not significant in this study, and similar results were seen in studies conducted by JNP et al., Samisri S. et al., and Campbell et al. The limitations of the study is this is a short-term non-randomized retrospective study. Due to this, the study was unable to estimate the long-term efficacy and safety of the drug. As the study is non-randomized and with no control group, it cannot infer if some improvement was due to improvement in systemic health of the patient. Coming to the conclusion, in this present study, intravitreal bevacizumab was found to be effective for treatment of macular edema due to retinal pathologies, and it's cost-effective compared to its contemporaries. OCT was found to be very effective tool in qualitative and quantitative assessment of macular edema along with the microstructural features. These are my references. Thanks.
Over to the judges, please, for the question and answer.
Hello, Dr. Kamlesh. Yes. Out of these all patients we studied, anyone was having injection insulin for the control of diabetes?
Yes, sir. Some of them were on insulin, sir, for uncontrolled diabetes.
But that doesn't make difference in your study.
No, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Kamlesh, it is a known fact that intravitreal bevacizumab reduces macular edema. So, yes. What were the new findings or take-home message in your study?
Sorry, sir. Sir.
Sir, ask what is the new take-home point in your study, as sir, it is sorry. A known fact. Dr. Kamlesh, can you hear us?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, can you hear us?
No, sir. Oh, the voice is breaking.
Are we not audible? Sir, ask you the question that what is new in your study? Then the please stop sharing your screen. Please stop sharing your screen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now please answer the question that what is new in your study? Dr. Kamlesh, the more the time you take for answering a question, the less number of the questions will be asked to you. So do you want to pass on the question? Then we can go ahead with the next question or the next participant. Dr. Kamlesh?
Hello, sir.
You're not able to hear any of the questions that we are asking you?
Sir, first question I could hear, but not the second.
Second
sir,
question is typing in the chat box. What's new in your study?
Sir, can you pass the question? Can you?
Yeah. Sir, any other questions from any other judges?
Kamlesh, what about the vision? In which stage of macular edema there is a vision good or less?
Sir, in our follow-up study, the vision was improved at first month. The improvement was seen in first month, and it was again progressively improved in say third and sixth month follow-up.
How much?
Sir, on logmar chart from 1.03 at the baseline, it will improve to 0.31 at the 6 month follow-up, the final vision outcome, the mean visual acuity.
Okay.
Kalyan sir, should we move to the next participant? Judges, is that okay to move with the next?
Yes, we should.
Yeah,
can go.
We already crossed the time.
Dr. Aparajita, you ready? Please start sharing your screen.
Good morning, sir. I am Dr. Aparajita from Salem, Tamil Nadu. Today, I am going to present the case of Fabry's disease that came to our OPD with ocular manifestation. My co-author is my HOD and professor, Dr. K. Edhilvendan, sir. The 20-year-old male came in our OPD with complaints of blurring of vision. Yes. Should I continue, sir?
Yeah.
Can you make it full screen?
Okay, sir. One
minute. I think she's sharing from the mobile, sir. Yeah. Okay.
That's all right. Good enough.
Yeah. Yes. A 20-year-old male came to our OPD with complaints of blurring of vision in both eyes, and the complaint was only for past 1 month, and the diminution of vision was gradual in onset and painless in nature. So the general systemic examination that was done by the medicine department showed CVS as all the functional tests were normal. There were multiple erythematous to hyperpigmented papules present over the lower back around the umbilicus and on both the thighs. Then we went to the ocular examination. The vision of right eye was 6 by 36 and left eye was 6 by 24. With pinhole, it was improving up to 6 by 18 in right eye and 6 by 18 in left eye. Head posture was normal. Facial symmetry was normal. And in primary gaze position also, right and left eye both were normal. Then on the examination, lid for right eye first, I will be telling, lid was normal in right eye and the conjunctiva was showing tortuous corkscrewing of the vessels. In cornea, there was a subepithelial haze present over the central and infratemporal area. Anterior chamber was normal in depth with no cells and no flares. Iris was normal color and pattern. Pupils were 3 mm round, regular direct and indirect light reflex was present. Lens was clear. Fundus, the media was clear, disc was normal, but vessels were very dilated and tortuous, and in macula, reflex was present. For left eye, lid was normal, conjunctiva same as right eye, tortuous and corkscrewing of the vessels were present. And cornea here also subepithelial haze was present, but only in the inferior area. Anterior chamber normal in depth, no cells and flares were there. Iris normal color and pattern. Pupil also normal. Lens also was clear. Fundus just like the right eye. The vessels were dilated and tortuous. These are the pictures of the anterior segment. The right eye and the left eye, both you can see there are tortuosity of the vessels of the conjunctiva, and down the cornea pictures are there with subepithelial haze, infratemporal area, and the left eye only the inferior area. Then in fundus picture, both the eyes show dilated and tortuous corkscrewing of the retinal vessels. The investigation period was a complete blood count in which hemoglobin was 12.5, total count for 11,300. And chest X-ray came up to be normal. So the treatment that we gave from our side was tablet B complex, tablet chlorpheniramine, and refreshed tears eye drops both eye four times for lubrication and the irritation problem. So this is Fabry's disease is an X-linked lysosomal storage disorder caused by a deficiency of the enzyme alpha-galactosidase A. Incidence is estimated to be 1 in 40,000 live births. And the systemic features include periodic burning pain in the extremities, angiokeratomas, cardiomyopathy, and renal diseases. Apart from that, there can be pain in the physical activity, heat and cold intolerance, fatigue, fever, flu-like symptoms. GIT, it can lead to diarrhea, constipation, or even abdominal cramps. Tinnitus can be there. And in ocular manifestations, majorly in the Fabry's, we see cornea verticillata, that is the haze we saw, conjunctival vascular tortuosity, lens opacity, and retinal vascular tortuosity. So this case mainly illustrates the anterior and fundus presentation of this rare case of Fabry's disease. Anterior segment showed conjunctival vessel tortuosity and subepithelial corneal haze, and fundus findings showed dilated and tortuous corkscrewing of the retinal vessels in both eyes, suggestive of Fabry's disease. Hello, sir. I'm done, sir.
Yeah, over to the judges.
Hello, Dr. Prijada. Good presentation. Yes. I wanted to ask what other changes you expected, saw, and then said they were not there in this Fabry's disease. And second thing, how you confirm this disease? What was the final diagnostic thing which you made this to be a Fabry's disease?
Yes, sir. Sir, in Fabry's, apart from conjunctival corneal retinal problems, lens opacity also can be seen. That can be anterior subcapsular or posterior subcapsular. That was not there. And in some ocular manifestation might be retinal arterial occlusion or retinal vein occlusion or ciliaretinal artery occlusion, or it can even lead to optic atrophy or papilledema. And there can be angiokeratoma on the lid, and patient can present with dry eye also. And sir, this case came to us as confirmed case of Fabry from another hospital. They had, the patient was saying that they had done the enzyme related test also, but the reports, I think it got misplaced or something, and we didn't have the report in hand, but it was a confirmed case of Fabry.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Aprajita, what is cornea verticillata?
Sir, sir, a hole-like pattern in the inferior corneal area, that is bilateral, that is white to golden brown in color.
Yeah, so did you have that pattern?
Sir, actually not fully, not a vertical letter, but a hole-like haze was there, sir, in the inferior area. But not exactly classical vertical letter, but the haze was gold pattern, sir.
Yeah, you had a round area which was subepithelial haze or whatever, but yes. There was no vortex kind of appearance, no?
No, sir, yes, not sir. Very classical. Yes.
So you can't really call it verticillata.
Okay, sir.
Any other causes for cornea verticillata?
Yes, sir. It can be due to drug inducer, chloroquine drug can cause corneal opacity, but that can show a cat whisker like of opacity, sir.
Okay. Any other drug?
Amiodarone, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
Dr. Aparijita?
Yes, sir.
Which type congestion is any specific congestion compared to other conditions in this?
What? Your, get it, sir?
In your patients, which type of congestion? Sir. Type of specific of congestions?
Conjunctival congestion, sir.
how differential diagnosis?
Sir, congenital congestion can be seen in other conditions like carotid cavernous fistula or arteriovenous malformation or carotid sinus thrombosis or thyroid eye disease also, sir, or scleritis also, sir.
How it look, this condition?
This was very tortuous and dilated, sir. Like,
What are the age groups?
Sir, this our patient was 20 years old, sir. Normally, Fabry's can be classical or adult, sir. Classical can be present since birth, and the other, it starts by the age of 30, sir.
What is the treatment of this disease?
Sir, classically, treatment should be enzyme replacement therapy, sir. But for now, we had only given B-complex as an antioxidant, refreshed years for burning and irritation of the eyes, sir, and chlorpheniramine as an antihistaminic, sir, for relieving of the burning sensation, sir.
Any preventive measure you have to
For Fabry, sir.
For preventing there, what will the concern?
Hello? Yes, sir.
For prevention, any counseling you have to do?
For ocular, we did counseling, sir, frequent blinking and refreshed tears uses. And for ocular complaints only, we did the counseling, sir.
Okay.
Yes. Do these changes reverse with enzyme therapy?
For this patient, sir. Yes. Hello?
In general.
Yes, sir. They have showed some improvement after enzyme therapy, sir. Like there is no progression of the disease and there's no progression of the disease, sir.
Okay. Dr. Sumit, shall we move on to the next?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for a nice presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you, judges. Now we'll move on to the next. Dr. Sumit, shall we?
Yes, please. Dr. Rita, ma'am, can you please share your slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please. Dr. Rita, ma'am, will be talking to us
about
manifestation during COVID pandemic in tertiary care hospital. Ma'am, please share your screen.
Shall I start, sir?
Good morning.
Please start.
Yeah. Full screen and start, please. We'll start your time.
Good morning, sir. I'm Dr. Rita Epsirani, Senior Assistant Professor from Government Tirunelveli Medical College, Tamil Nadu. My topic is ophthalmic manifestations during COVID pandemic in a tertiary level hospital. The aim of the study is to study the ophthalmic manifestations in patients attending tertiary level hospital. An objective is COVID-19 has become the global pandemic since December 2019, transmitted by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. The ophthalmic manifestations due to coronavirus ranges from mild to severe conjunctivitis, orbital cellulitis, to central retinal artery occlusion leading to complete loss of vision. And in this paper, we discuss about the epidemiology and various ophthalmic presentations of the patients presented to our department since 2019 December. Lack of eye protection is the major risk factor for transmission and direct effect due to the virus, immune-mediated tissue damage, activation of the coagulation cascade and prothrombotic mechanism induced by the viral infection, the associated comorbidities and drug used in the management are responsible for the findings in the eye. The viral RNA has been isolated from ocular tissues, but the role of eye as a route of infection is yet to be substantiated. Methodology, we collected the details of patients presented with various ocular manifestations during this COVID pandemic since December 2019. In our study, there were 35 patients with various ocular presentations. Complete ophthalmic evaluations were done in these cases. All the cases, the RT-PCR were taken, and CT chest, blood investigations like TC, DC, hemoglobin, platelet count, ESR, CRP, LDH, D-dimer, and serum ferritin levels were taken for all the patients. CT, PNS, and CT brain were taken for needed patients. The patients were examined by ophthalmological team and the ENT and dental surgeons, physicians, and neurologists. So discussions were. Common age group affected is mostly from 30 to 75 years. More 23 patients were less than 50 years and 12 were more than 50 years. And sex ratio, male predominance we noted. And ocular manifestation, 22 cases we have seen orbital cellulitis. And 10 cases conjunctivitis and 2 cases of multiple cranial palsy, 1 case CREO. And orbital cellulitis, the microbiological results were mucormycosis seen in 9 cases, candida in 2 cases, rhizopus in 2 cases, aspergillus 1 case, and no growth were noted in 8 patients. And COVID RT-PCR was positive in 6 patients. And the outcome was 30 patients recovered and 5 patients died. And one of the patients with the pan ophthalmitis, we did evisceration last year. And this year we had put a prosthetic eye. And results out of 35 patients, 22 patients were orbital cellulitis, most all are diabetics and had poor visual acuity, ranges from 1/60 to 3/60 with a total ophthalmoplegia. Out of 12 cases had bilateral sinusitis and 10 had unilateral sinusitis. Tests were done for 13 patients. Evisceration done for 1 patient and prosthetic eye implanted after 1 year, and 1 patient went for thysis spontaneously, and 5 patients expired, others recovered. 10 patients presented with membranous conjunctivitis and they were treated with antibiotics and they were cured, and 2 had multiple cranial palsy and they are coming for follow-up, not yet completely recovered. And one patient with presented with impending CREO and recovered with now after treatment, the patient visual acuity improved to 6/60. Among these patients, 6 patients had positive RT-PCR tests. Others were had finding COVID findings in CT chest. And a mucormycosis is a life-threatening opportunistic infection. Patients with moderate to severe COVID-19 are more susceptible to it because of the compromised immune system with the decreased CD4 and CD8 lymphocytes. Associated comorbidities such as diabetes mellitus, which potentiates both the conditions, decompensated pulmonary functions, and the use of immunocompressive suppressive therapy, corticosteroids for the management. Mortality rate is as high as 50% even with the treatment. The factors responsible are pre-existing viral infection, high dose of steroids, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, mask reuse, and low serum ferritin levels in the patients encourages the mucor growth. And precautions to be taken or oxygen delivery should be clean distilled water used for humidification. Avoid misuse of steroids and control of systemic diseases and treatment. Systemic amphotericin B, retrobulbar amphotericin B, peribulbar liposomal amphotericin B, and extensive cases, debridement and excentration is advised. So conclusion of my studies, it is clear that the ocular morbidity has an increased incidence during this COVID pandemic, in which the comorbidities also play an important role. Sometimes ophthalmologists may be the first person to examine a COVID patient, since in most of the cases has ocular manifestation as the first symptom. Hence, it is emphasized that all patients presenting with ophthalmic manifestation should be screened for COVID-19, and ophthalmologists should handle the cases with maximum safety measures. And take home messages in saving lives. Let's not forget the sight. Thank you, sir.
Hello, Dr. Rita, madam. It was the study in first last year, na? That was last year.
Yes, sir. Last year, sir.
So, can you imagine ki if somebody does same study this year, what will be the differences? What you found, and the study which somebody will do now. You got some orbital cellulitis, mucormycosis, conjunctivitis, CRA occlusion, you know. So what is the change we are?
Actually, last time the hospital say of the patient is more, sir. So now during this pandemic, we have seen 1 cases of mucormycosis, and the patient is, in spite of all the fuss and all, the patient expired, sir, because the severity, lung involvement is more severe. It shows a lot of difference, sir. Last time, the hospital stay is more cases recovered. But during this episode, more deaths are common, sir. We are not able to see the most of the ocular findings, sir. We have enough number of COVID positive cases, but we didn't see that as much as cases, sir.
And then CRA occlusion case which you treated, what was the treatment given? Which patient required some vision?
Sir, the patient immediately we gave for the ocular massage, sir, and methyl prednisolone given. And then we sent the patient to the cardiologist opinion, sir. Some thrombus noted in the internal carotid artery. And they started on antiplatelet and atorvastatin, sir. And slowly the visual acuity improved. Now he's doing good. Presented with 1/60 and now he's 6/60 improved, sir.
When you these patients were attending OPD, as you said, every patient we used to consider that it may be COVID positive. What, short, you can say, precautions you took to check the patients during this pandemic?
Actually, all these patients are admitted cases, sir. They're with the ocular findings, they refer to the ophthalmology. We went and see the cases, sir, because the whole campus 1,000 cases are COVID positive cases. We actually not presented with symptoms, sir. Positive cases with the ocular findings we have seen, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Rita, thank madam, you, how many patients you have seen panophthalmitis?
Panophthalmitis, actually, 10 cases we have seen, sir.
10 cases?
10 cases, sir. Mm-hmm. Almost certain cases, spontaneous, one case subsided, sir. Still, he is coming for follow-up with this phthisis bulbae. He is improved with the FES alone and antibiotics and, sir, and good diabetic control. One patient, we did evisceration, sir. Other 6 patients died. In spite of all these measures, they died, sir.
Patient died out of 6?
Out of, no, sir, out of 22 cases, we have seen for orbital cellulitis, sir.
Panophthalmitis patient, you have seen 6 patients, na?
Yeah, 6 patients already there, 6, sir, with lung involvement more, sir.
Or not?
Sir, not audible, sir.
Have patient died or not due to panophthalmitis further?
Not due to panophthalmitis died, sir. Their lung involvement is very high, sir. Poor oxygen saturation, so comorbidities. Because of that, they died, sir.
Okay.
Good study, madam. In this pandemic scenario, if a patient is coming with conjunctivitis to the OPD, what are you, how are you managing that?
Sir, we are wearing the face shield and slit lamp also, we are having that shield, breath shield, sir. And in such a cases, next to our department is the COVID ICU, sir. We'll send for the patients to take a swab, sir.
All patients of conjunctivitis, you'll be sending for this? RT-PCR or rapid antigen? Or...
No, sir. So, with the fever and rhinorrhea and typically with the congestion and chemos is with not a slightly watery discharge, sir. So, in such a patients, we'll suspect and send for taking an RT-PCR test, sir.
Okay, madam. And this mucormycosis, you're saying it was more in the first wave or it's more in the second wave?
Sir, more in the first wave, sir. This time I've seen one case, sir. That patient also died, sir. After FES also, given amphotericin B and posaconazole, everything with the treated, but the patient's severe lung involvement, sir. Patient not recovered.
Because everywhere else, people are seeing lot more mucor in this wave than in the last wave. So that is.
I understand, yes.
Yeah, I don't know, sir. Here in the scenario is like that, sir. We didn't see that cases much, sir. So because one etiology I know is that last time the survival rate more time they are in the hospital stays, sir. This time they are very sick and the hospitals. I don't know, sir. I didn't see one case only we have seen, sir.
Yeah. Tamil Nadu somehow is saved from mucormycosis this time, sir. I spoke to a few of my colleagues there. Mm-hmm. Even they don't have a lot of cases of mucormycosis still now.
Yes, sir.
Okay, madam.
Thank you for your presentation, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
We'll move on to the next speaker. Dr. Kirti, for some reason, could not join. Dr. Sumit Dongre, please start sharing your slides. His topic is study of effect of NDR capsulotomy on coronary endothelium.
Sir, this is Kirti Patibanda. I have joined the session, sir.
Okay, great. Then can you please start sharing your screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
regarding this mucor very less in Tamil Nadu, we should find out the cause because it is so rampant everywhere.
Sir, is my screen visible, sir?
Yes, very much. Please start presenting.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Kirti, and I'm here to present a case report on a patient with ocular ischemic syndrome who presented to our ophthalmic OPD with chief complaint of sudden and painless diminution of vision in right eye since morning. He's a known diabetic and on regular medication with oral hypoglycemics and had no history of ocular or head injuries, periorbital pain, photophobia, floaters, metamorphopsia, diplopia, or phosphenes, amaurosis fugax, nor had any history of headache, transient ischemic attack, CVA, or seizures. He's not known hypertensive nor having any cardiac history. Coming to ocular examination, his best corrected visual acuity in right eye is CF 1 meter and in left eye it is 6 by 18. His extraocular movements were full, free, painless in all gazes in both eyes. Both the pupils reacted normally to light and are of normal size. There is no RAPD. In the left eye, there is grade 2 nuclear sclerosis noted. The rest of the anterior segment examination is within normal limits in both eyes. His intraocular pressure on applanation tonometry in the right eye is about 15 millimeters of mercury and in left eye it is 16 millimeters of mercury. The fundus examination performed with indirect ophthalmoscope showed the following findings. In the right eye, the media is clear with plane mirror and at 1 meter and 25 centimeters. The optic disc margins, size, shape, color were normal and showed a cup disc ratio of 0.3:1. The vessels were significantly arteriolar narrowing and stiffening with venous dilatation, but there was no venous tortuosity. In the mid-periphery, there were multiple and diffuse dot-blot hemorrhages and microaneurysms, but there were no exudates or cotton wool spots or new vessels noted. The rest of the fundus is normal, macula is normal, and the fundus is tessellated. Coming to left eye fundus, the media is hazy due to grade 2 nuclear sclerosis. The optic disc is normal. There is mild arteriolar narrowing present. The rest of the fundus is normal, macula is normal, and tessellated fundus is noted. These are the fundus drawings of right eye and left eye respectively. In the right eye, we can see that the disc is normal. There is significant venous dilatation without tortuosity as well as arteriolar narrowing. Diffuse dot plot hemorrhages are spread along the mid-periphery along with microaneurysms. The macula is normal. Whereas coming to OS, the disc is normal. There is slight arteriolar narrowing and the rest of the fundus is normal. Coming to investigations on OCT, the macula appears normal in both eyes. His fasting blood sugar was about 88 mg per deciliter and postprandial is 257 mg per deciliter. Blood pressure is 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury. His hemogram, LFT and RFT were within normal limits. Lipid profile was run, which showed increased triglycerides in total cholesterol levels and decreased HDL levels. Carotid Doppler was performed, which demonstrated a fibrofatty plaque of 2.3 mm in the right carotid bulb, causing a luminal narrowing of about 45 to 50% with hemodynamic changes and diffuse intimomedial thickening was noted. The left carotid study was normal. His ECG was within normal limits. MRI brain with orbits was performed, which showed age-related mild diffuse cerebral atrophy and no other significant abnormalities were detected. The patient was conservatively managed and advised medical consultation for further management and regular follow-up at our OPD for IOP measurements, fundus and visual acuity charting. He was started on calcium channel blockers, TAB ecosprin 75 mg once daily and TAB atorvastatin 20 mg before sleep. At 1 month follow-up, the visual acuity of the patient spontaneously improved in right eye. With glasses, it improved up to 6 by 12 partial. In left eye, it is 6 by 18. On fundus examination, we noted that there was resolution of dot blot hemorrhages in right eye. Thus, with all the above positive findings in history, ocular examination, carotid Doppler, along with asymmetrical presentation and spontaneous improvement in visual acuity, a diagnosis of right eye ocular ischemic syndrome was taken. This is the 1 month follow-up patient fundus picture with 20D showing resolving hemorrhages which are noted superotemporally with some artifacts of the macula. And in the left eye, media is hazy due to grade 2 nuclear sclerosis and the rest of the fundus is normal. Coming to discussion, ocular ischemic syndrome is a rare vision-threatening condition associated with severe carotid artery occlusive disease, which could be due to stenosis or occlusion leading to ocular hypoperfusion. Its incidence is more in males than in females and in patients with poor collaterals. The other signs of ocular ischemic syndrome include conjunctival and episcleral injection, corneal edema, desperate membrane folds, RAPD, rubiosus iridis, AC flare and cells, aspiratory cataract or arthritis, macular capillary keratitis, retinal AV communications, Cottonwood spots, cherry red spot, neovascularization at disc elsewhere, and choroidal neovascularization, vitreous hemorrhage, asymmetric diabetic retinopathy, anterior ischemic optic neuropathy, orbital pain, ophthalmoplegia, and ptosis. On fundus fluorescein angiography, delayed choroidal filling time and prolonged AV transient time is the classic finding. On ERG, as both the choroidal and retinal circulations are compromised, a decreased amplitude of A and B waves can be noted.
1 minute left.
On VEP, on inducing photostress, increased latency and decreased amplitude is noted. Medical management modalities include calcium channel blockers like verapamil to combat vasospasm, to control IOP, topical beta blockers or alpha adrenergics, topical steroids to suppress inflammation, cycloplegics to stabilize blood aqueous barrier and limit iris movement, panretinal photocoagulation and intravitreal antivagals or triamcinolone if new vessels develop, cycloablation in cases of painful blind eyes, and surgical management modalities include carotid artery endarterectomy, carotid artery stenting, extracranial intracranial arterial bypass surgery. The differential diagnosis include non-ischemic CRVO and diabetic retinopathy. Thank you. I'm done, sir.
Over to the judges.
Hello, Dr. Kiti. First question is, how you differentiated this as a ocular ischemic syndrome from, as you said, differential diagnosis of diabetic retinopathy?
Presenting feature is asymmetrical presentation and sudden presentation, asymmetrical presentation, along with classical mid-periphery distribution of dot blot hemorrhages and microaneurysms, whereas in diabetic retinopathy, the microaneurysms and hemorrhages are most commonly located at the posterior pole, as well as macular edema is more common in diabetic retinopathy, whereas its occurrence is quite rare in ocular ischemic syndrome. In diabetic retinopathy, we can see most commonly hard exudates located as a succinate retinopathy around the macula, whereas hard exudate presentation is not seen in ocular ischemic syndrome. And the classical association with the carotid artery occlusive disease supports the diagnosis of ocular ischemic syndrome and favors it when compared to diabetic retinopathy.
Second question is, why you are not done fundus fluorescein angiography?
Sir, the patient could not follow up to us as it was during the COVID time, and we could not refer him to other institutes also, sir, as fundus fluorescein is not available with us at that time, as ours was a total COVID hospital.
Okay, but if it is available and situation is easy, then what it would give more than what you learned from the OCT, Doppler, etc.?
Yes, sir. On fundus fluorescein angiography, we classically see a choroidal delayed filling time followed by arteriovenous transit time is also classically increased. And in the late phase, we see arteries staining of the arteries and also the veins due to the ischemia. Whereas in diabetic retinopathy, we do not see the staining of arteries or veins. Whereas in CRVO, we see the staining of veins more than arteries.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
And Dr. Kirti, how many patients you have seen?
Sir, I have seen only one case. This is the only one case we have seen, sir. So I have presented it as a case report, sir. It's not a case series.
After treatment, how was the vision prognosis?
The vision improved spontaneously to the patient after 1 month follow-up up to 6/12 partial with glasses correction, sir.
Okay.
We have given only medical treatment with calcium blockers, ecosprin, and atorvastatin, and advised him regular follow-ups for IOP measurement and visual acuity charting. So at 1 month follow-up.
And blood hemorrhages, you are not given any treatment?
No, sir. We have just observed, sir. We have not intervened for the dotted blood hemorrhages, sir. They have spontaneously resolved at 1 month follow-up.
Dr. Kirti, there were no anterior segment findings of ocular ischemic syndrome in this. So
yes,
to confirm the diagnosis, I think FFA would have been mandatory to call it ocular ischemic syndrome.
Okay, sir.
And what was the cause of this thing, diminution of vision in the right eye?
Sir, carotid Doppler was performed to the patient, which showed about 45 to 50% of luminal narrowing on the right side, with intimomedial thickening, a plaque of 2.3 mm was noted, sir. Whereas in the left eye, there is it was a normal carotid Doppler study.
No, but why was the vision reduced? What was the pathology in the eye?
It is a global ischemia due to carotid artery compromise, leading to both choroidal as well as retinal circulation compromise, leading to ischemia and decrease in the visual acuity.
And does it recover so well after treatment, like ocular ischemic syndrome? It's more of a chronic thing.
1/3 of cases can recover spontaneously, sir, whereas the 2/3 of cases, they have a comparatively poor prognosis.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Kirti. Dr. Lahane, sir, has joined the meeting here. Sir, we have Dr.
Good morning, sir.
Kashinath
Chaudhary, sir.
Vin Sabni, sir, as our respective judges. And
good morning,
sir, as a moderator.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, sir.
I was hearing the Kirti speaking. And Milind, thank you, Milind. Thank you, Kashinath.
Good morning.
Thank you, Khurshed. Thank you, Kalyan. I think you were doing good job. And she was also answering the good questions. Thank you very much. And all the speakers who are presenting the cases, my best wishes to them. Thank you, Sumit.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir.
Please go ahead.
Next participant is so Dr. Sumit Dongre. Can you please start sharing your screen?
Yes, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah. Yes. Make it full screen.
Just full screen.
Okay.
The time starts.
Good morning, all. My topic is study of effect of indirect capsulotomy on corneal endothelium, a teaching hospital-based prospective study. As we know, the cataract surgery is the most commonly performed procedure in the ophthalmic practice. The incidence of the PCO rate could be 11.8% at the 1 year, 20.7% at 3 years, and 28.4% at 5 years after the cataract surgery. Dense membranous Sommering rings and the acinic pulse, these are the types of the PCO. PCO causes significant reduction in the visual acuity, impaired contrast sensitivity, glare disability, and the monocular diplopia. The structure and function of the corneal endothelium is assessed by this specular microscopy. This is the picture of the specular microscopy showing the different parameters. In this week, we see the central corneal thickness, endothelial cell density, coefficient of variation, and the hexagonality of the endothelial cells. Coming to the indirect laser capsulotomy, it is the procedure to treat the PCO with a success rate of the more than 95%. The principle is it causes the tissue disruption by the ionization. Most common adverse effects of the indirect laser capsulotomy, these are the intraocular pressure elevation and the system macular edema and so on. The aim was to assess the corneal endothelium structure and the function before and after the indirect laser capsulotomy in patients with the PCO using the specular microscopy. It was a prospective observational study done on 50 out of the 50 patients conducted within the 4 months of the time period. All patients underwent SICS with rigid PMMA IOD implantation operated by the one surgeon in past. Patients with PCO presented to the ophthalmic OPD and underwent NDI capsulotomy were included. Patients with corneal pathology, active uveitis, pseudo-exploration syndrome, traumatic cataract, and diabetic patients were excluded. Coming to the methods, first, written informed consent and the detailed history were taken. Detailed ophthalmological examination was done. Then pupils were dilated with the hypodilating drops. Antitopical anesthetic drops were put. NDI capsulotomy was performed on slit lamp equipped with the Q-switch double frequency NDI laser with use of the Abraham lens in seated position. The energy used was 1.8 to 4.2 millijoule depending upon the type and thickness of the PCO. The laser beam was placed at the 125 micrometer posterior focusing mode. 4 mm cruciate incision was made starting from the 12 o'clock to the 6 o'clock position. Then multiple shots were taken at the edge of the capsule opening, progressing laterally towards the 3 and 9 o'clock. Then total cumulative energy were calculated. Post procedure, flubipropion and the timolol eye drops were started. Patients were followed up at the 1 week and the 1 month post procedure. At each follow up, intraocular pressure, posterior segment, and the IOL plating was assessed. along with base corrected visual acuity, endothelial cell density, coefficient of variation, and exorbitant VRFs. The first picture shows the QSH double frequency intact laser with the Abraham lens, and the second picture shows the cruciate incision made during the capsulotomy. Statistical analysis were done with the chi-square test and the ANOVA test. Coming to the results, about 72% patients above the 60 years of the age, 54% patients were the female, 68% patients having the ethnic pulse type of the PCO, and base corrected visual acuity was compared from pre-laser to the 1 month, 1 week and the 1 month follow-up. We can see the significant increase in the BCVA at 1 week and the 1 month follow-up. And the mean endothelial cell density was compared from the pre-laser status to the 1 month follow-up. At pre-laser, it was 2,356.76. At 1 week, it was 2,231.8. And at 1 month, it was 2,199.2. The mean energy required for the ethnic pulse type of PCO was 54 millijoule, and for the fibrosis type of PCO was 86 millijoule. The mean hexagonal cells also compared from the pre-laser status. Pre-laser, it was 65.34%. At 1 week, it was 62.02%, and 1 month, it was 60.42%. We can see there is significant reduction in the hexagonality of the cells. Then the comparison of the mean coefficient of variation also done from the pre-laser status. Pre-laser, it was 33.74%, and at 1 week, it was 35.58%, and at 1 month, it was 37.22%. There is significant increase in the CV count from the pre-laser status, which shows that there is polymegathism. Coming to the discussion, in our study, the fibrosis of a PCO required 86 millijoule, which was significant higher as compared to the 50 millijoule mean energy required for the ethnic pulse type of PCO. Agarwal et al. In their study also reported the similar findings. Dharmaraj Jubi et al. Noted that there is improvement in the BCVA in 95% cases, which is similar in our study also.
1 minute left.
Here the comparison of our study and the Rajab et al. Study is made. There is a decrease in the endothelial cell density and hexagonality from pre-laser status to the 1 month follow, and there is increase in the CV count. Limitations of the study was the sample size was small of 50 patients, and the another limitation was the duration of the follow-up was shorter, and the endothelial cell density was recorded not recorded beyond the 1 month. Coming to the conclusion, India glass capsulotomy is a safe, effective, non-invasive method for the treatment of the PCO. Our study showed that there is a significant decrease in the corneal cell density following indirect laser capsulotomy at 1 month follow-up. Hence, in order to reduce the damage to the corneal endothelial cells, it is necessary to minimize the laser energy delivered in the eye as much as possible. These are my references. Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Sunil. First question. You did capsulotomy in different cases. So, have you studied the duration when you did capsulotomy, like in early first year, third year, or few cases are like a late
BC? Sir, it is between 6 months to 2 years actually.
Over to the judges, please.
6 months to 2 years. So, yes, do you feel as the patient grows according to age?
You can stop sharing your screen, Dr. Sumit.
Sir, voice is breaking, sir. Hello.
Dr. Sumit.
You can stop sharing your screen now.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Do you feel ki as the cases which lately treated for PCO, because of age, there might be some change in the corneal endothelium count?
Yes, sir. Due to the age, there may change in the corneal endothelial cells.
So that is PCO, sir. Because you studied only the endothelial cell count after this capsulotomy is done. But have you considered age also? Because age also is increasing by 2-3 years after cataract surgery. That should be taken into account.
Yes, sir.
And yes, how do you explain that endothelial cell loss after your capsulotomy?
Sir, actually, your capsulotomy causes the destruction in the endothelial cells, which causes reduction in the endothelial cell density, which is significant from the 1 week to 1 month follow-up, sir, compared to the pre-laser status.
Okay.
Hello, Dongre. Hello.
Yes, sir.
What special precaution you have taken to reduce the endothelial damage? Special precaution.
Sir. Sir, the lens was used, sir.
Which?
Abraham lens was used, sir, and the patient is in sitting position, sir, and the other eye should be fixated at the fixation center.
Your focus might be exact.
Yes,
what
sir.
Is the mechanism of NDAC laser?
Sir, it causes tissue disruption by the formation of ionization. Actually, it forms the plasma, sir.
Any more?
Yes, sir. Which?
Okay.
Dr. Dongre, have you correlated the total amount of energy delivered versus the cell count loss?
Sir, actually, we compared the total amount of energy required in ischemic burst type of PCO and the fibrosis. At the fibrosis type of PCO is thick.
No,
so energy required is more, sir.
Did you see the energy delivered was more than the cell loss was more? Any such correlation did you check out? So that can be a take-home message to keep the energy low.
Yes, sir. So, sir, energy should be, minimum energy should be used, sir, to reduce the endothelial cell density.
No, you could have charted out the total amount of energy delivered versus the percentage of cell loss. So that would have given you a better idea. And you could have seen whether that is statistically significant.
Yes, sir.
Any such study done in laser PI, which is much closer to the endothelium and energy used is also much more. Is there any such study that you know of?
No, sir. Sorry, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit. With your permission from the respected judges, we have one more participant, Dr. Rishikesh Mai. Dr. Rishikesh Mai, coincidentally, is a faculty in the strabismus in the same session at present going on. So he has to go back. So with due permission from the judges, is it okay if he presents now and then go back to the primary session?
Okay, no problem.
Okay. Rishikesh, you can start sharing your screen here.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, very much, sir.
Okay. Good morning. At the outset, I would like to thank the BOA, MOS, and Sumit, sir, for giving me an opportunity to present one case. Actually, it's an interesting case which I had faced a couple of months back, and I hope none of you have to face it, especially after cataract surgery. Unexplained visual loss explained. 76-year-old female with complaints of both eyes, blurred vision since 3 months presented to me. She was a known case of systemic hypertension for 10 years with good control with oral antihypertensive medicines. She had been treated for Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia with chemotherapy for over an year. And the oncologist, 6 months back before she presented to me, the oncologist who had been treating her suggested that the condition had remitted and did not need any further further treatment. So the patient was well oriented in time, place and person. However, the relative said that during the chemotherapy, she had a few episodes of depression also. On visual acuity, her best corrected visual acuity, both eyes was 6/60 for distance, N18 for near. Anterior segment showed a senile cataract, NS3+, PSC. Goldman's applanation tonometry was 14 millimeters of mercury in both eyes. Fundus examination, I was able to visualize only the central part, which showed the disc and macula appeared normal. The periphery was hazy because of the cataract. So with this in mind, we diagnosed her as senile cataract, and the visual loss was probably because of the amount of cataract she had correlated with the amount of visual loss. So we advised cataract surgery for her. Left eye first, as the patient suggested. The surgery was spaced at 3 days apart between the two eyes. It was a phaco emulsification and uneventful surgery. The post-operative first day after the second eye surgery, her vision had improved to 6/18 for both eyes. The cornea was clear, anterior chamber was quiet, and the PC IOL was in place. However, the thing started going downwards the next day when she presented with complaints of headache and visual loss. We checked her vision that day and it appeared like perception to light for both eyes. So I actually got a bit upset, thinking in terms of endophthalmitis or something like that. But the anterior chamber was quiet as it was on the previous day. The pupillary reaction was sluggish, but well sustained with no relative afferent pupillary defect. The fundus was also normal. Just to rule out any subtle fundus or macular problem like macular edema, cystoid macular edema postoperatively, we happened to do the OCT for both eyes, but it did not reveal any macular edema or any obvious macular pathology. So we were thinking what can be the cause of sudden visual loss bilaterally in this case. I had actually seen a case of PION sometime back, not my own case, but somebody else's. And so that was also in my mind. AION was another possibility, or as the relative suggested that she was a case of she had episodes of depression during the chemotherapy. I was also thinking in terms of malingering. So anyway, I investigated her further, blood sugar, CBC, SR, and C-reactive protein, everything was normal. So I referred her to a neurologist for a flash VEP. The neurologist colleague suggested that no, it was not malingering. In fact, she had a delayed latency and reduction in amplitude. So we advised MRI brain plane and flare sequence, and this is what we got. Actually, there is a hyperintensity, asymmetrical involvement of the posterior parietal and the occipital lobe. This was the axial scan, which was also, this lesion was also seen in the parieto-occipital lesion, parieto-occipital part of the sagittal section as well. So we consulted the radiologist who suggested that probably she had, considering her history of treatment for Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia with chemotherapy, it could be a case of what we call it as PRESS or posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. We referred her to a neurologist who confirmed the diagnosis, and both the neurologist and oncologist, they did not offer any treatment as such, because apart from her visual loss, physically she was normal, BP and everything was normal, and they simply reassured her. In the meantime, I went through literature and found that the visual outcome is usually good in these cases. And fortunately, this patient also had something like that. At 10 days of follow-up, her vision had improved to 624. But during those 10 days, I had 3 or 4 sleepless nights, considering that I put a premium IOL in this patient. So the last follow-up was elsewhere. The patient did not belong to the place where I practice. The ophthalmic colleague suggested that her vision is 612 and N8 and the last follow-up. Due to COVID, she has not followed up with me in the last couple of months. Just a word about PRESS or posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. It presents with headache, confusion, seizures, and bilateral visual loss. There is vasogenic edema involving posterior parietal and occipital lobes, but other part of brain may be involved. It is postulated due to probably cerebral hyperperfusion or endothelial damage. Usually the patient age group is more than 45 years and comorbid conditions. So any comorbid conditions like these in more than 45 years of age group with sudden visual loss, especially treatment for malignancy, immunosuppression therapy, HIV patient, this PRESS has to be kept in mind. It was just a coincidence that I had the patient had this immediately after cataract surgery, though the surgery was probably not related to it. They usually PRESS will present with visual symptoms, usually like visual hallucinations and visual loss. However, in 85% of cases, the visual outcome is usually good after 2 to 3 weeks. Like in my patient, it was at 10 days. Slower recovery is usually rare. These are the different literature. Most of them are from neurology journal. What I would like to suggest is only the fourth, that is Caridi et al., an Italian group. Last year, they have found PRESS in a 65-year-old patient who had recovered from COVID-19. So not all cases with visual loss in COVID-19 can be mucormycosis. Rarest among the rare, you should keep PRESS also as a differential diagnosis. Thank you.
Over to you, judges. Sir,
thank you, Dr. Rushikesh. Already, you have nicely presented a case, and that unexplained visual loss investigated and got the conclusion.
Yes.
You explained that it was a coincidence, but only my query is: was it having any relation with this within 3 days operating both eyes?
Can you stop sharing the screen, please?
Yes. Please. Just.
Thank you. Thank you.
you operated both 3 days. So was it having any because patients, when they are posted for surgery, they have some stress. So within 3 days, 2 times operated and with that original disease, does it make the difference? Or it was a coincidence totally?
I actually went through literature and considering that we had taken fitness from physician and oncologist who gave us a go ahead with the surgery, probably coincidence can only be explained. Though anxiety because of surgery has not been postulated to be associated with development of PRESS. So I think without surgery also perhaps she might have developed the condition which she developed ultimately.
Okay, thank you.
Rishikesh, which part of brain region it may be loss of the vision?
Occipital lobe, sir. Usually it is either posterior parietal or occipital lobe are usually involved in these cases. Though brainstem lesion have also been associated following PRESS, but that is very rare.
So, is it maybe in trauma, loss of such type?
She did not give any history of trauma.
Okay.
Yeah, Dr. Rishikesh, nice, interesting case. Yeah. What was the COVID history of this patient? Was a COVID test done before surgery?
We usually do COVID tests for all preoperative to cataract surgery. That COVID test was negative. That's why we went ahead with it.
Okay. Yeah. Nice presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Next, Dr. Harshita, please start sharing your screen. Dr. Harshita there?
Yes, sir.
So she will be talking to us on the rare case of Usher syndrome.
Sir, is my screen visible, sir?
Yeah, very much. Please make it full screen and start presenting.
Yes, a very good morning, everyone. My topic for today is atypical Usher syndrome type 4 with syndromic retinitis pigmentosa. As we all know, Usher syndrome, it is categorized under National Organization of Rare Disorders to be a rare entity, and it is autosomal recessive inheritance. And there are 3 types of Ushers. The main difference between type 1 and type 2 is both type 1 and type 2, there will be a the main difference between type 1 and type 2 is type 1, there will be absent of vestibular dysfunction, and type 2, there will be the vestibular function will be normal. Type 1, there will be the MOA gene will be muted, and USH1C gene is muted. Type 2, USH2A gene is muted. Coming to type 3 Usher syndrome, patient will be usually presented with second to fourth decade, and they will be having retinitis pigmentosa with better vision, and there will be progressive hearing loss. Gene associated with the type 3 or CLR1 and PDZ7 gene. So in my case, what makes it so unusual? So this is my case report. A 47-year-old gentleman, Mr. Arul Bale, he came to OPD with complaints of history of defective vision in both eyes since 2 months and history of blurring of vision in dim light for past 6 months. He also had a past history of sensorineural deafness since 20 years, and he was on hearing aid for the same. He gave history of both a cataract surgery done 5 years back and both a YAG capsulotomy done 2 years back. There is no specific relevant family history according to the history given by that patient. His two sibling, he had two sibling, and they were perfectly normal without any eye symptoms. Then coming to the ocular examination, his both eye visual acuity was 6/12, and his best corrected visual acuity is improved up to 6/9 with spectacles. Then on a slit lamp examination, his both eye anterior segment was found to be normal, and his both eye pseudophakic with posterior chamber intraocular lens in place, and YAG capsulotomy opening was seen. Then on a dilated fundus examination by using 90D lens, feature suggestive of RP was seen. mild pale waxy disc was seen with intraretinal mid-peripheral bony spicules were seen with arteriolar attenuation. So this was the fundus picture of him taken by using SD-OCT in our department. Then macular function test we did, and by using amsular grid, and both eye was normal. Visual field and full field ERG he had done outside. We referred the patient outside, and that report showed mild peripheral visual field defects with reduced V wave. We got ENT surgeon's opinion. There they did Pioton audiometry, and they confirmed that the patient is having bilateral moderate to severe sensorineural deafness. And there they advised for tuning of the hearing aid. Then, in order to rule out any systemic association with the retinitis pigmentosa and to rule out refsems, we seek the general physician opinion. There on examination, they told like tandem working difficulty was present and finger nose test clumsiness was present. Restall test found to be normal. And then he was diagnosed to have bilateral minimal cerebellar degeneration and advised for MRI brain with cerebellar cuts to confirm the diagnosis. And we did MRI brain and it showed mild bilateral cerebellar atrophy. So now we were in a dilemma between refsems and Usher's disease because the patient, there is no obvious symptoms to indicate cerebellar ataxia, and serum phytanic acid we tried in giving lab which turned to be inconclusive. Then on thinking about Usher's, the patient had sensorineural hearing loss, but vestibular involvement was not there. So we try to do gene study, genetic study we done, and there we find out this homozygous missense variation in exon 11 of ARSG gene that results in the amino acid substitution of cysteine for arginine at codon 4-4. So ARSG gene mutation was found, and Usher syndrome type 4 was found. Based upon the history and diagnosis of exclusion, we concluded four. The patient had late adulthood onset of sensorineural hearing loss without vestibular involvement, retinitis pigmentosa, and ARSG gene mutation. So this case is reported for its rarity, and to stress the importance of systemic evaluation in all retinitis pigmentosa patients, multidepartmental intervention is needed. Although definitive treatment is not available, early diagnosis, appropriate management, and educating the importance of follow-up will improve the quality of life and survival. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
You can stop sharing now. Over to the judges.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Harshita, for a nice presentation. In that National Organization of Rare Disorders, which other diseases are there? Do you know about that? Reported, like you reported this case, na, as a rare disorder.
Yes, sir.
Like that, any history is there where previously ophthalmic rare disorder is registered or recorded? Other than this, your.
Sir, other syndrome disorders. Like
Caisse-Nayer syndrome. Okay. Then in your presentation, you said there are three types. Type 1, type 2, type 3.
Yes, sir.
So this is the one you are saying, type 2, 4 atypical Usher's.
Atypical, yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. At what stage it is now? It is applied to that national organization. So any reply from them?
No, sir. Very few literature articles were there supporting this atypical Usher's type 4.
Mm-hmm. So not you have not got yet reply from them?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Otherwise, nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Harshita, what about the differential diagnosis?
Sir, differential diagnosis, we had refsems in mind, sir.
What are the findings?
Sir, because the patient had a mild cerebellar dysfunction, so we thought of we thought of cerebellar ataxia, but it came out to be only symptoms like tandem walking, that is only difficulty is present, and the rest all test found to be normal, sir. Like handwriting was good, and the report MRI brain report also came to be mild cerebellar atrophy. Mainly the distinction between
lepsums and ushers
will be different.
What is the treatment in your
patient? Sir, we have prescribed glasses for his vision because his central vision was spared. So we have prescribed glasses for the patient. Apart from that, there is no specific treatment for retinitis pigmentosa, sir. Prophylactically, we can give vitamin A,
any surgery,
supplements, lutein.
Any surgery for RP? Any success or not? So what about the rehabilitation?
Sir, low vision aids can be planned for the patients in future if his vision is deteriorating, sir. Low vision aids.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, Harshita, nice presentation.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me some syndromes of which have got retinitis pigmentosa and deafness?
Sir, lepsums.
Is that the only one? There are a couple of syndromes where you have deafness as well as retinitis pigmentosa. So that would come into your differential diagnosis, I think.
Okay. Kaestner-Harris syndrome.
Yes. Yeah, you can check that out.
Chronic.
Yeah. And what type of vision aids are given for retinitis pigmentosa?
Sir, we can go for low vision aids, sir.
What low vision aids?
There are many types of low vision aids. Telescopic aids that can be used along with the spectacles.
What will be required in retinitis pigmentosa? What is the issue in the vision?
There will be center tunnel vision at advanced stages, late stage.
Okay. So what type of visual aid? Okay, fine. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Meghna, are you there? Dr. Meghna, can you start sharing your screen? Dr. Meghna?
Yeah.
She'll be talking about demographic, clinical, and microbiological pattern of infective corneal ulcers. Yeah. Dr. Meghna, please start sharing your screen. Any problem, Dr. Meghna? Dr. Meghna, any problem there? I think she had some internet problem. Dr. Preeti is here. Dr. Preeti? Dr. Preeti? Okay. Dr. Preeti? Anyway, Dr. Indrajit Shinde? Dr. Preeti, can you hear us?
Hello?
Hello?
Just a minute.
I think Dr.
Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, who is this?
Dr. Indrajit Shinde, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Indrajit, please start sharing your screen.
Yes, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Not yet. Yes, it is now. Please make it full screen, stand present.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. My topic of paper presentation is a study of dry eye parameters in diabetics in a tertiary care hospital. According to the TFM Ocular Society workshop conducted in 2017, dry eye is a multifactorial disease of the ocular surface characterized by loss of homeostasis of the film and accompanied by ocular symptoms in which a TFM instability and hyperosmolarity of ocular surface inflammation and damage and neurosensory abnormalities play an etiological role. Diabetes mellitus is a major public health concern affecting 21.9% of the city population. Risk factors for diabetes mellitus associated dry eye syndrome include chronic hyperglycemia, diabetic peripheral neuropathy, decreased insulin levels, microvasculopathy, systemic hyperosmolaritic disturbances. The aim of the study was to study the frequency and severity of the dry eye in diabetic patients and their correlation with the duration of the diabetes. It was a cross-sectional prospective study conducted on all patients having diabetes above 40 years of age presenting to the ophthalmology department, and the study was conducted over a period of 2 months. Prior clearance of the institutional ethical committee was taken. Patients that were included in the study had a history of diabetes above the age of 40 years. Then patients that were excluded were patients having ocular disorders like keratoconjunctivitis, Fabry's eye disease. Then patients receiving systemic drug treatment like beta blockers, Thiazides. Then patients having history of ocular surgery like glaucoma surgery, cataract surgery, and pterygium excision. Then systemic diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, Sjögren's syndrome, and lupus erythematosus, as well as patients wearing contact lenses were excluded from the study. A written and informed consent was taken from the subjects, and demographic data and detailed history was recorded for the predetermined pro forma, and all patients were asked about the duration of the diabetes as well as along with the dry eye symptoms such as ocular discomfort, soreness, grittiness, itchiness, redness, blurring of vision, photophobia, and excessive tearing. Ocular examination of all the patients was done. Visual acuity was tested with the help of the Snellen chart. Anterior segment examination was done by slit lamp biomicroscopy. Corneal sensation were tested. IOP was measured with non-contact colorimeter. Fundus examination was done by direct and indirect ophthalmoscope. Tear film breakup time test and the Schirmer's one test are the most applied clinical tests so this, to diagnose the dry eye syndrome and thus were performed in this study. Schirmer one test in this 41 Wortmann filter paper is used to folded from one end, and the folded end is gently placed over the lower palpebral conjunctiva at this lateral one third under aseptic precaution, and the patient advised to keep the eyes open and look upward. After 5 minutes, the strips were removed and the amount of the wetting was measured from the folded end of the strip. The results after 5 minutes were graded as follows. More than 10 mm was considered as normal, 8 to 10 mild, 5 to 7 mm moderate, and less than 5 mm was considered as a severe dry eye. For Tibet, the lower fornix was stained using a peristyle strip of the 2% fluorescein after instilling topical anesthetic drops. The patient was advised to look straight without blinking while seated on a slit lamp and was observed using a broad beam of a cobalt blue light. The time taken for the appearance of the first random dark spot was noted. Results were graded as follows. More than 10 seconds for appearance of dark spot was considered normal, 8 to 10 seconds was considered mild, 5 to 7 moderate, and less than 5 seconds was considered severe dryness. Statistical analysis was calculated. Frequency and percentage was obtained by calls for qualitative characters. Mean and standard deviation was calculated, and a p-value of less than 0.05 was taken as statistically significant. A total 100 eyes of 1250 patients were included in the studies, of which 26 were females and 24 were the male patients, and most of the patients were from the age group of 61 to 70 years. Distribution of dry eye symptoms in the study population, most of the patients had no symptoms, that is 60% of the patients. Then other patients can complain of burning sensations, sensation of dryness, redness, itching, and watering. Patients with no dry complaints about Schirmer 1 and Tibet test positive were around 18%. This is table shows the grading of the Schirmer 1 test and association with duration of diabetes along with the pie chart of the Schirmer 1 test. From the pie chart, we can see that the 26% of patients had mild dryness, 14 patients had moderate dryness, and 8% had severe dryness according to Schirmer 1 test. And as the duration of diabetes increases, the severity of dry eye also increased, and the p-value was less 0.00, which was less than 0.05, which concludes that statistically significant. This is a according to Tibet, the 40% patient had mild dryness, 18% moderate, and 10% had severe dryness. In Tibet, as well as the severity, as the duration of the diabetes increased, the severity of the dryness increased, and the p-value was
0.00,
which was statistically significant. Diabetes is a common association seen in patients with diabetes. The study had a high proportion of female patients, similar to study done by Kurana et al. Mean age was 60.46 plus or minus 9.74 years. In Alzarosha et al. Had 88 diabetic patients with a mean age of 55 plus or minus 10.1 years. Frequency in this study, diabetes in this study was 68%. In Nep et al., in their study found 43% of diabetics having dry eye disease. In this study, the values of both Sharmar 1 and Tibet test were reduced in diabetic patients, which is similar to a study done by Dogru et al., in which the Sharmar 1 test had a mean value of 7.70 and Tibet had around 9.28. The majority of patients in this study had mild dryness, which is similar to the study done by the Kamal et al., in which the Sharmar test had a 38% of mild dryness and Tibet showed 40%. In this study, the duration of diabetes increases, so the severity of dryness also increased, which was statistically significant as shown in table 2 and 3, which is similar to the confirmed by studies done by Zheng et al. And Managia et al.
Your time is up.
Sharma 1 test performed lack sensitivity and lack of standardized procedure for application of the Tibet test. Conclusion, most of the patients having diabetes have abnormal iris and severity of dry associated with duration of diabetes, and tests Tibet and Sharma should be considered part of routine checkup. And early diagnosis and timely management is important for the progression of the dry eye. These are my references. Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Indraji. What is the message from your study?
Sir, as the diabetes...
Sharing the screen, please.
Most of the patients of diabetes is more common, sir. So diabetes should be considered for dry eye disease in the diabetic patient. Sharmars and the Tibet should be regularly done exam for the assessment of the dry eye in this patient.
Okay, thank you.
Any questions?
Dr. Indrajit?
Yes, sir.
Did you have a control group with normal patients? Because after the age of 40, a lot of normal people also start having dry eye. So how do you attribute it to diabetes and not a normal progression?
Sir, other patients, the control group was not considered in this case, but all other conditions which are like vitamin A deficiency, then vernal keratoconjunctivitis, which are common conjunctival diseases, these diseases were excluded from the study. So we were mostly focused on the diabetic patients and the progression of a dry eye in this patient.
What is the incidence of a dry eye in above 40 normal individuals? Have you any idea?
No, sir.
Okay. Have you heard of non-invasive TBUT?
Yes, sir. Non-invasive, it is done with the help of the coronal topography machine, in which the every second the meniscus is checked and the appearance of the first dry spot is noted, sir.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shinde. We'll move on. Dr. Harshit, Dr. Meghna is ready with the presentation. Dr. Meghna, please start. You're not very much audible. Can you be please louder?
Yes, sir. Now
is it audible? A lot of echo there, but yeah, please try and present.
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. My paper presentation is on the topic of study of clinical and microbiological profile of infective corneal ulcers at a tertiary care hospital in Western Maharashtra.
Voice is not clear.
And your slides are also not moving. Can you move on to the next slide, please?
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry. On the left-hand side, you can go, and there will be arrow. On the left-hand side, there will be arrows. slow down. Yeah, yeah. Please keep your device close to your face so you'll be more audible.
Sir, now is it?
Okay, but not very good. Okay, try presenting.
So now is it okay?
Somehow, please start presenting.
Sir, is it audible now?
It's better now. Please start presenting.
Yeah, please start.
Yes, sorry, sir. Corneal infection can lead to corneal scarring and blindness if not diagnosed quickly and managed appropriately. Corneal ulcer is the second most important cause of infective blindness throughout the world after trachoma. Monocular blindness due to corneal diseases is seen in 1.5 to 2 million new cases annually. In India, about 6.8 million are blinded because of this corneal disease, and it is one of the causes of a long-term visual impairment. Hence, it is considered an ophthalmic emergency requiring an immediate and appropriate antimicrobial treatment. Predisposing factors include injuries, fluid malpositions, topical medications like steroids, contact lens wear, and autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis. The prevalence of ulcers varies according to the climatic conditions, occupation, socioeconomic status of people in different parts of the world. Optimal treatment in time can reduce serious complications like corneal perforations, endophthalmitis, or even panophthalmitis. This study highlights the importance of demographic risk factors typically present in features with diagnostics involved in infective corneal ulcer cases in Western Maharashtra region. The aim of the study is to study the clinical and microbiological pattern of infective corneal ulcer cases. Materials and methods: it was a retrospective analytical study done on 68 eyes of patients who had presented with an in 2019, that is a period of 2 years, at a tertiary care hospital, and it is based on the previous medical record. All patients with infective corneal ulcer above 18 years of age were included in the study, and the patients having neurotrophic keratitis, exposure keratitis, keratoconus and corneal dystrophy, Murren's ulcer, perforated corneal ulcer, panophthalmitis were excluded from the study. A detailed history was taken, a written informed consent was taken, and a consent for inclusion in study and consent for procedure of scraping was taken. A detailed ophthalmic evaluation was done. The important being the SAC symptoms, which is for patency of lacrimal passages, corneal sensation testing, staining with fluorescent strips to detect any epidefect if present, anterior segment examination, and the slit lamp photographs and color color diagrams were recorded for documentation and to assess the progress. Corneal scraping was done with a number 15 surgical drain under topical anesthesia. This is a slit lamp photograph of the bacterial corneal ulcer case which we had treated. Here you can see the fluorescent staining, and next after the healing, the BCVA was fixed in this case. Microbiological findings of corneal scrapings were done using RAM staining to detect any bacteria and 10% KH norm to detect any fungal hyphae. The viral corneal ulcers were diagnosed clinically based on the characteristic dendritic or geographical pattern associated with loss of corneal sensation and presence of skin lesions for skin. Coming to the, slides visualized. Coming to the results, the age group of patients in the study ranged from 18 to 90 years, with majority, that is 88.22%, in the age group of 26 to 70 years, with a mean age of 50.81 years. And 61.77 were male in the study, and the male to female ratio was 1.61:1. Coming to the best corrected visual acuity at presentation, 47.05% presented with a BCVA of less than 6 by 60. Occupation, coming to the occupation, 41.17% the farmers were occupation, and the next majority being the construction workers. Clinical features of the infective corneal ulcer cases, 54.41% cases presented with ulcer size of less than 5 mm and only 27.94% had hypopyon. Central and paracentral ulcers were the more commonly observed type of clinical features in 83.81% of the cases. On the microbiological profile, only 41 eyes had conclusive scraping reports on gland staining and 10% KOH. fungal etiologies are found in 31%, bacterial etiologies in 23%, and mixed etiologies in 20%. Hello. Rest 40% were clinically assessed and accordingly treated as per the clinical treatment findings. In the discussion in the present study, male preponderance was seen for infective corneal ulcers. Age group most affected by infective corneal ulcers was 26 to 70 years, which was comparable with other studies by Katara RS et al., Rajini CY et al., and Gopinath U et al. By occupation, majority of patients in the present study were farmers, comparable to studies by Mohad et al. And Srinivasan et al., Gopinathan U et al. In our study, 32 patients had a BCV of below 660 at presentation, and this was comparable to a similar study by Kadka et al., which had 41% of patients with microbial keratitis with BCV less than 660. Coming to in this study, involvement of central and paracentral cornea was seen in 83.83%, which was also comparable with the cases of central paracentral ulcer seen by Karipi et al. And Puri LR et al. Coming to the size of the corneal ulcers, the size of ulcers less than 5 mm were seen in 64.41%, which was comparable to studies by Karipi et al. And Puri et al. In our study, most of the cases were of fungal etiology. This was because farming is the main occupation of the patients, and vegetative trauma is more common. The limitations for sample size was comparatively small. The study did not include culture sensitivity of corneal scrapings to isolate the specific organisms. Conclusion: infective corneal ulcers are more common in working males. Gram stain and Kaolin mount of corneal scrapings are similar. Simple and quick OPD investigations that are helpful in detection of the type of microorganisms in order to start a specific antimicrobial treatment. These are my references. Thank you.
Hello. First question is, what was the organism found in that location, paracentral area, corneal ulcer, infective keratitis? Which was the organism? Do you remember? In your study, paracentral.
Yes, sir. Here, most of the cases were of fungal cases.
Most of the cases were fungal. Okay. And have you studied like clinical observation from that the organism and whether it is matching with the microbiological results?
Yes, sir. We had asked the patient to have done the staining and taken a slit lamp photograph as well. And then most of the cases which we have found clinically were coordinated with the microbiological research.
So what was the
40% of the cases had the microbiological support.
Okay. Thank you.
Meghna, how it looks the fungus corneal ulcer?
The fungal corneal ulcer has raised edges with a dry surface, and there is a presence of feathery margins. Along with there is presence of satellite lesions, which are also characteristic or pathognomic of this fungal ulcer.
Okay.
Meghna, did you find?
Yours, sir. Thanks, thanks.
Yeah, Meghna, did you find out what the organisms were in the bacteria and the fungus specifically by culturing?
Sir, culture and sensitivity, we could do only for a few cases, sir, because the population here is not very educated and affordable. But whatever we had found, it was mostly Staphylococcus aureus found out, sir. Like as many as we could do only around few of them, sir.
And what about the fungus?
Fungus, sir, Fusarium species, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Preeti, can you please start?
Yes, sir. Can I audible, sir?
Dr. Preeti, can you please start sharing your screen?
Am I audible?
Dr. Preeti?
Dr. Preeti, need to be a little louder.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, but need to be louder. Start sharing your screen, please.
Not yet. Preeti, we are already running short of time. Will you be able to share your screen? There in the lower part of your Zoom meeting, in the green share screen button. Dr. Preeti,
I am unable to share my screen.
Dr. Preeti, I think there is some problem.
Yes, sir.
If you are not able to share, it's okay. We can shift you to the another session, but we are already running short of time.
Okay.
Judges, I think we are done with all the participants here. Dr. Preeti could not present because of some technical issue. So we'll shift her to another session as how it is possible.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you all the judges. Thank you. Thank you, Sumit. Thank you all the judges. Once more.
Thank you, Kalyan.
Thank you all the participants.
There were a lot many take home points and very excellent inputs from all the judges about all the papers. Thank you so very much
for this excellent session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you.
I hand over the session to the PQ finale to Dr. Prashant Bhavan.